So this is again the different parts that we have in a speech recognition system. We have this feature extraction, acoustic models, language models, and this lexicon with the words that we have in our language, and it's a pronunciation transcription. So in the first talk, I was talking about replacing this feature extraction part and these acoustic models with a deep neural network. The idea was to compute the probability of the phonemes. We do this segmentation with 30 milliseconds frames every 10 milliseconds. We put here a deep neural network using the usually the spectrum, maybe the spectrum of these 30 milliseconds. So we're still using Fourier here, at least. And then at the output of this deep neural network, we have the probability of each of the phonemes. And we are using these probabilities with the information provided by the dictionary. So we have the pronunciation of all the words. We have a hello, and we expect to have, if we say hello, we have to expect, the probability of this first phoneme of hello, this part, then the probability of the second, very high in the output of the deep neural networks, etc. So this is not all. This is not easy task. We are not having a clear probability of this phoneme. It is not clear what is a phoneme and this spectrum. There is a lot of variability, as I mentioned before. But if we join this information, but with the limitation in the vocabulary, and also if the, in some phrases, the language model can help. As I say, numbers, language model does not help. But in a spontaneous conversation, on a reading, especially in a reading conversation, a presentation, the language model is very important. It can help us to finally, from this phonetic information of each of the words and the language model, we obtain a sequence of words. The problem is that, well, we have here 100 frames per second. Our speed, usually we have 10 phonemes per second. We model that standard way with hidden Markov models, that we can remain in the same phoneme or for 10 frames, for example, and then change to the following phoneme of this word, hello, etc. So this is in the following slide, this part is the hidden Markov model part. So in the previous talk, I've been replacing all these steps by the deep neural network. So we are here. And this is still most practical system, still using this specific hidden Markov model in the system, in the speech recognition system. But we are replacing, are we beginning to replace parts of this model. We are simplifying maybe the hidden Markov model and trying to include also part of these restrictions, this sequence of phoneme, or just to try to teach the deep neural network also this phonetic pronunciation using the same training data speech test used for training the acoustic models. So this is presentation about one speech recognition system developed by Baidu Research. Baidu is a Chinese company. In this case, it's Baidu Research has a group working on speech recognition in Silicon Valley. And they were experts on, more experts on deep learning than in speech recognition, and try to replace at least two blocks with just a recurrent neural network. Also, you can also try to replace this block with a recurrent neural network, or try to combine the standard Ingram count-based language model with a recurrent neural network. But the complexity is also higher. And then you can have problems also if you want to have a speech recognition system for millions of persons. So this is a work that started maybe 10 years ago, but the first real system with a good performance in a serious problem task, I mean, with a good language model and good results, was this by Baidu in 2014, and another version, Deep Speech 1 in 2014, and Deep Speech 2 in 2015. And the idea is, as before, no using specific features for speech, just the spectrogram. There is no need in this Baidu system for this phonetic part. So there is no phonetic transcription dictionary, and no, there is no hidden Markov model. There is no specific model with this simple hidden Markov model, but they try to include that in the network. And also, they're also important difference because respect to previous systems is that there is now no aligned connection between the input and the output. In previous systems, when we try to train this deep neural network for phonetic classification, we start maybe some with a classical system based on Gaussian mixture models or a simple system, and we try to have this alignment between frames and phonemes. So we train these networks with a training database where we have the frames, and we have also decided what is the phoneme that we have in each of the frames. This is a segmentation problem in phonemes that is, we have to do that with a previous system. For example, using a classical speech recognition system, just to try to do segmentation and having training data aligned phoneme by phoneme to train these deep neural networks. In this case, the output are phonemes. But she don't like phonemes, this Baidu research group, and they don't want to use a previous system, just start from scratch to train their system. They use this approach that is called connectionist temporal classification. That's the we have this input speech, we have a series of speech, and the output has to be a sequence of letters. So, for us, I mean, for me, to speak about a speech recognition system is much more simple in this case. Just need to put this slide, and I say the input is the spectrum, and the output as the letters. That's a speech recognition system. Fantastic. Okay, you have to include some of these states and this sequence in the model. The model has to train, has to learn this phonetic transcription of words. In fact, it's the inverse. We have to go to the phonemes, to the letters. Might be difficult for some languages. And now the recurrent part is, of course, is more important. We have to have a good recurrent part just to keep these constraints about the sequence of phonemes that we expect in a word. And we have also to learn something about the language model here, not only words, but maybe also language model. The problem, again, is the sequence of words, the number of words that we have in a transcription, even in 2,000 hours, in 5,000 hours they're using, is very limited. I mean, we can have maybe 100,000 words, or I don't know, 10,000. But in tests, in the net, in internet, in books, maybe we can train language models with billions, so 1,000 times the time of test that we have in transcriptions of recordings, transcriptions. There's, we can have a more much powerful language model using all the tests. Reading books is good to learn a language. So even if they're obtaining these good results just with letters, if we add a language model, this language model is also important in this system. I list in English. Maybe in Chinese it's not so important because you have a lot of a lot of characters, and the words has few characters. The first system, the 2014, was using just one bidirectional recurrent neural network. Then, at the next year, they added more recurrent neural networks up to, I don't know, 7 here, and improved the results, of course. But still, the input is the spectrogram, one spectrum every 10 milliseconds, and the output are letters, when we have a letters, and blanks in the middle, because the input here is 100 frames per second. The output is maybe 9 letters per second. So this slide about how important is still the language model. In Chinese Mandarin, using this 9-layer deep speech 2 system, the performance without no language model is 7.5 word error rate, or maybe character error rate, I don't know. Yes, this case is in Chinese. The performance of the picture recognizer is usually measured in character errors instead of words, since the word is not clear what is a word in Chinese. So it is usually measured in how many errors do you have in characters for Chinese, and in English is 4 words. There is still a big difference of using and not using words in English, not so different, but it's important, still important to use this language model, this information from billions of words that we have in test. In fact, I think I have, look here. So one of the challenges of this system is how to train this network without alignment. I mean, we cannot assign a priori what is going to be, what is the output of each frame. And it's better if we don't do that. I mean, maybe it's we can, if we listen to these recordings, maybe for us the D is here, but the system needs previous frames, but also the following frames to decide and take the decision that this is really this D. So we want to give freedom to the system to adapt the network to have this output anytime. So the output has to be the dog. Why we don't pose any constraints, how and when do we want to have this output? We give freedom to output this, and there is also a lot of blanks in the middle. So the system has to learn that and can learn that with more freedom, but it is a really more complex way of training the database. It's a more complex way of calculate or computing the back propagation, how to adapt the weights. There are many possibilities at the output. So with the idea, they developed this CTC algorithm. And you can see here a nice representation of how this CTC algorithm learns and what is the difference between this CTC algorithm and the premier framewise algorithm. So for the previous systems, we need to have this alignment. And we want to have high probability during of one phoneme during all the duration of the phoneme. For example, the phoneme S, we have the phoneme S. So with the previous approach, the frame-wise approach, this was depicted here. We want to have a high probability of this phoneme during all the duration of the phoneme. For this CTC approach, we just want to have this S output once in one frame. And the network, during the training, decides when it's going to have this output. It has to be before the corresponding output. So there is a sequence, just a sequence, but it can output it here or later, maybe after, for example, or as in some cases here or before, even before. But the good point, this is more complex to train, but it also works. And it don't requires no initial models, no force alignment. This is a general idea that you can use any sequence to sequence learning when the length of the input is different from the length of the output, or when there is no clear a priori alignment, as I mentioned with the phoneme task. When you go to, that is more simple, but when you go from letters to phonemes, you may skip one letter. There is not always a clear correspondence to letters and phonemes. Maybe two letters are corresponds to one phoneme in English, or that is letters that has no pronunciation, has no phoneme correspondence. So you can maybe try also a similar approach based on CTC for the problem. And Baidu was expecting to be this system much better than the previous system when we increase the model size, when we increase, sorry, the model size and the data of the system. But also they also use another techniques to improve the performance, like adding noise to this 2000 Fisher database, 2000 hours, trying to have a very large database, but it's a synthetic data, not very good, but maybe better than not using additional data. And these are the results in red. In this is the Baidu Deep Speech One. The results in a standard database that is used for speech recognition evaluation. This is the word rate in two tests. And the performance was really good at that time. It was the best system 2 years ago. But IBM and also Microsoft have been also working with this idea, but with some hidden Markov models there. So and still using phonetic information, and the results are much better. Still now with using phonetic information. If you have that phonetic information, and it's good phonetic information, you can still use that and still. It's not necessary to output the letter at the output of the network. You can just let the network to output the probability of the phonemes and then use the phonetic dictionary. And then a good language model or a combination of language models, traditional and recurrent neural networks, to improve the results. So the BEC systems right now are by IBM and Microsoft. It's about, 6.6 and 11.1. So we are still improving a lot with deep learning year by year. And this is, according to Microsoft, close to the human performance. I don't believe so. I mean, maybe just with this database, with the training that is quite similar to this database, the performance is close to human performance. But in general, in a noisy environment, even in a bar, even when you are talking, are several persons talking at the same time, the performance of human performance is quite higher than the performance of speech recognizer. But it's also true that these systems with very high performance, better than this Baidu system, are really, really complex systems. So for features, they have a combination of 10 techniques with a lot of acronyms there. You have to design a previous system with traditional Gaussians, then from the alignment, and then train your system. They are using a combination of three different deep neural networks for the acoustic modeling with convolutional neural networks, recurrent neural networks, and fully connected neural networks in parallel. There are also sophisticated training, iterative training systems, and very large networks. And also a large combination of deep neural networks. And the performance was better, but quite close to this very simple system. Just one recurrent neural network, and was a simple language model, language model based on foreground. Well, I mentioned the difference between the new system was improved performance with a more complex, at least more deeper, recurrent neural network. And of course, for them, the system was the best one compared to Google and Apple. But it's not, you don't have to believe everything. These comparisons, I mean, depends. It depends on the task. All of them are good systems. But you have a, yeah. This is a comparison of the performance of those systems by Baidu and the human performance. And now the performance of the Microsoft system and the IBM system 2016 are similar to this, the human performance. And this is, as I mentioned, the standard number of hours. But I mean, in this case, for this task, since the test is quite close to the training data, I mean, the same conditions, the same kind of dialogue between two persons, you can have very good results just with this Fisher database that you can buy, at least you can buy. But of course, every company, as Google, Apple, has own recordings and can add more recordings, more hours, and improve the results. But this is the standard today to use about maybe 2,000 hours, very good system, 10,000 hours, excellent system for the state of the art. This is also important to keep in mind the computational cost of this training. So they also invest time, money in having a good system and how to use many GPUs in parallel with a good performance. So they also try to reduce also the time using linearly with the number of GPUs. And I don't have, no, I have time with a demo, but you can listen to that demo. It's okay. You have time. So that's all for my presentation. Speech recognition. Of course, if you want to know more about speech recognition, you need a longer class. So there is a master class of master course on speech technologies. If you are interested in that, that is beginning this semester. Any questions?
Okay, well, thank you.